piece is called Jean-Michel Basquiat, 1961 to 1988. Kid, I didn't want to like your work. I felt it didn't cook, not quite well done. I am guilty, like all the rest who attended your openings, to see which hip, cheek, faces showed up. Yeah, you had your Warhol crowd. I kept my back up against the wall. Your name rang far and wide. I stopped you on the street asking you to support a local politician in the East Village. You looked at me as though I was crazy. You commented how you saw me at the dance clubs and you wanted to know my name. God, the pussy you must have turned down. Never mind the whatever. Some say your heart was as good as gold, G-O-A-L. I feel you came too fast, success-wise, that is. I loved you because you were accepted by the chosen few. You were getting a lot of play. I remember your Mary Boone opening and wondering if you were banging your brains out. At Bahumian, you autographed a poster that I wanted dedicated to a friend in Paris. You wanted to know my name. You looked hurt. I never relaxed around you because I never relaxed around the Warhol crowd, Studio 54, Max's, Cobra, etc. You may have been the only real person to expose the scene for what it is, a death wish. After wandering the streets of New York and having no sleep for 2 days, I decided to pass some time in an East Village bar. I sat at a corner table that would permit me peace and quiet. This solitude was soon interrupted by a beautiful black woman. Her features were exquisite. Wavy black hair, close cropped in a boyish cut. She asked me to buy her a drink. I did. She then began to describe her unhappy childhood. She spoke about being cursed with beauty and not being accepted as a person. I sat back, pretending to be sympathetic to her plight, harboring fantasies of luring her into a fleabag hotel where I had rented a room. I suggested we go to my hotel on the Upper West Side of Manhattan. I hailed a cab and looked at the stunning temptress. I asked her name. She responded with an exotic sound that made me forget the question. The cab stopped in front of the hotel. I took the key from my pocket and we rushed upstairs. Once in the room, I explained that I had been living in the hotel for 3 months. I made the best of the situation by surrounding myself with good books and music. She asked me if I had anything to get high on. I pulled out some reefer. We smoked and slowly began to explore the excitement of touch and lust. I slowly undressed her while admiring her sensuous facial expressions. The chemistry we shared must have excited her because her dream... Excuse me, must have excited her beyond her dream because as I unhooked her bra, she blurted out the name Mona. I massaged Mona's body for an hour before I removed her panties. I made romantic movements that seemed to heighten Mona's lust. She began grasping and holding me. She wanted me to hold her tighter. I felt powerful. I knew that this woman was mine, body and soul. I fell asleep, curled up in Mona's embrace. The night passed by quickly. The morning came. Being an early riser, I woke first. I looked down at my beautiful lady friend and saw with satisfaction the beautiful look that was etched onto her face. I had to go out and cash a check, but since Mona was really a stranger, I thought maybe I should get her out of my path. My ego would not permit me to think that this woman would wrong me after having been blessed by me the night before. I locked my stereo in a closet and rushed out to cash my check. I need not explain the great mood I was in after having had such a successful sexual encounter. I arrived back at the hotel an hour later, thinking of inventive positions to try out on Mona, my sepia beauty. I approached the door to my room. As I thrust the key into its hole, this funny feeling ran over me. You know the feeling when something's wrong. I opened the door. The cheap lock on my closet door had been broken. There was no Mona. I hollered at the top of my lungs, how dare this trick rob me after I trusted her and entrusted her with the tool of my wisdom. I ran to the management, threatening to sue them. I went back upstairs and began to cry. I cried out of bitterness and love for the beautiful wench who violated my space. Evening came. I was shattered from running around New York trying to get a lead on the woman that swiped my lust. I returned to my room. The phone rang. It was Mona, calling to apologize for hurting me. I hated her, but at the same time, I felt like begging her to tell me who she sold my belongings to. She volunteered to do so. I developed an erect stance. I begged her to come over, making a complete fool of myself. I wanted to know how she could rob me after we made such passionate love. She laughed and said, I was so macho. Was she right? Thank you.